Daniel here is speaking of the time of Jacob's trouble. This is Jeremiah's reference to what Daniel says in Daniel chapter 9 is the 70th week of a 70-year prophecy. You can pick up the tape, get the notes on those online. And now Daniel is concerned about the nation of Israel. So throughout chapter 12, as the Lord speaks to Daniel with respect to your people, he is speaking to the people of Israel. And it's important to kind of set that, because with those that are in the replacement theology realm, and that's a realm that believes that all the promises for Israel in the Old Testament were replaced by, that's where replacement, the word replacement comes, replaced by the Christian church simply because they were the Christ killers. And God does not do that with his promises. You can believe on the enduring, eternal quality of God's promises. And as the psalmist and as Isaiah does, and here Daniel did as well in chapter 7, you are welcome to remind the Lord of his personal promises for you and believe that he has said it, he will do it, and that's all there is to it. Hallelujah. So now in the close of Daniel 11, we're beginning in chapter 12. Of course, you recognize that Daniel did not write in chapters or in verses, so it's a one continuous vision. This fourth vision that started in chapter 10 is now being completed, or the vision's coming to its finality here in chapter 12. And verse 1 of Daniel 12 is written, "At that time, Michael shall stand up, the great prince who stands watch over the sons of Israel," or your people. "And there shall be a time of trouble, such as never was since there was a nation, even to that time. And at that time, your people, Israel, shall be delivered, everyone who is found written in the book." Now, we have to question then, what time are we talking about? And the close of chapter 11 really set the scene with respect to what era or what season of time that would be. In chapter 11, verses 36 through 45, we were speaking specifically about the days in which the Antichrist will be ruling as a globalist leader over three great corners of human society. That will be politic, economy, and religion. And it will really come down that way, in that order, as it were. Most believe that he will begin to grasp the politic of the revived Roman Empire as pictured in Daniel's interpretation of Nebuchadnezzar's dream in Daniel chapter 2. There on that statue, Daniel saw 10 toes of iron, the empire of Rome, mixed with clay, which is the substance of man's makeup. So it is man adulterating the empire in a manner in which it makes all the other empires of earth, of human history, unstable. For Daniel saw that a great mountain from heaven would soon fall upon the empires of the earth and completely annihilate all empires. And this is a picture of Christ coming again. Christ coming at the close of the 7 years of Jacob's trouble, or the tribulation, and in fact setting up for himself a millennial kingdom, a 1,000-year kingdom of Christ bodily sitting upon a throne in Jerusalem, waging, bringing a rod of reproof on all nations. And in fact, all nations will need to come to Jerusalem every year for the Feast of Tabernacles, the Feast of Sukkot, to honor the Lord God who is above all other gods. Now, that's going to be troublesome for some nations who at this point today, if they survive the tribulation, have a great anger and have an interest in annihilating all Jews and the nation of Israel. They have that interest today. There have been other nations in the past that have had that interest, and they have all failed because, listen closely, the church hasn't replaced the promises of God for Israel. Israel still is promised by God to be kept and one like David upon the throne of Israel forever and ever. So we're introduced again to this man, this divine being, this angel. He is not a man. This divine being by the name of Michael. We were introduced to him in Daniel chapter 10, and he is referred to as the prince of the nation of Israel. He is the overseer. He is the angel that watches over Israel. We are told of two other nations who have angelic princes over them, Persia and Greece, in that same chapter. And it lends to the grand possibility, we can't say this dogmatically, but we can say that it is likely there are angelic beings that oversee all the nations of the earth. And truth be told, Persia and Greece, these angelic beings who are at war with Gabriel and Michael in the heavenlies concerning this last vision of Daniel, there are angelic beings that have a twisted, very evil plot for the nations of mankind. And they are stood back by the angels that God has assigned to these nations. And it may be likely that also to great states and cities as well. But this Michael is a great archangel that helped Gabriel overcome the prince of Persia and the prince of Greece. This is the same Michael, the prince of angels, who fought against the devil over Moses' body and in fact won, we're told in Jude verse 9. Michael, in fact, is he who will fight against Lucifer himself, and this is likely where all these battles go on, in the heavenlies in Revelation chapter 12. And Michael succeeds again. We, of course, recognize that divine beings like angels cannot be killed. All right? They were born, created in an eternal manner. Guess what? So were you. So were you. There was a time when we did not exist, and there was a time when we did, when in our mother's womb, at that powerful point when those two wonderful cells came together in your mother's womb, that God, our Lord Savior Jesus, breathed life into you, and breathed not just physical life into you, but breathed eternal life in your spirit and soul into you. And as peculiar as it may be, we have the propriety in our lives to decide where we want to spend eternity. Now, the book is referenced in verse 1, and we need to take time to talk about not only the power of this book, but the tremendous horror of your name being blotted out of the book, okay? So we're going to take a little bit of time to do that, but now this time of trouble that is coming. We'll see in the notes this morning that Isaiah called it a day of vengeance. Jeremiah referred to it as a time of Jacob's trouble or the trouble of Jacob. Daniel referred to it as the 70th week of a 70-week prophecy. Zephaniah refers to it as, in chapter 1, the great day of the Lord, a day of wrath, a day of distress and anguish, a day of trouble and ruin, a day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and blackness, a day of trumpet and battle cry. That great day, that day in human history will be one that has never been in its power recognized as having occurred previously. Jesus says that there will be great tribulation, Matthew 24, verse 21 and 22. such as has not been since the beginning of the world until this time. No, nor shall ever be. Verse 22 of Matthew 24. And unless those days were shortened, no flesh would be saved. But for the elect's sake, these days will be shortened. Once again, Jesus there, speaking of the elect, is speaking of the nation of Israel. Because the point of Jacob's trouble is Jacob, and Jacob is Israel. Well, your people throughout this chapter 12 will be the nation of Israel. Make sure that you recognize that. When we speak of them being rescued, Jesus speaks of this as well in Matthew 24, which theologians refer to as the Olivet Discourse, because he's on the Mount of Olives when he tells his disciples. They ask, well, what's it going to be like? He says, well, this is exactly what it's going to be like. Now, what about this book, the book that comes at the close of verse 1? Well, it can only be the Lamb's Book of Life that is referenced several times in the book of Revelation, and in fact is referenced in Old Testament scripture as well. The Church of Sardis in Revelation chapter 3 is told something in a letter from Jesus to that church that is quite unstilling, unnerving, not only for churches, but I would suggest to individual Christians as well. Please note, these are the things that Jesus is saying. I'm not making this up. I'm not trying to precede this with some doctrinal point. But here's what Jesus says to the church of Sardis. Please write. Revelation chapter 3, verse 1. These things, says he, who has the seven spirits of God and the seven stars, as he introduced himself in Revelation 1 to John in Isle of Patmos. He says to Sardis, I know your works, that you have a name, that you are alive, but indeed you are dead. Be watchful and strengthen the things which remain that are ready to die, for I have not found your works perfect before God. Remember, therefore, how you have received and heard, and hold fast and repent. Therefore, if you will not watch, I will come upon you as a thief, and you will not know what hour I will come upon you. You have a few names, even in Sardis, who have not defiled their garments, and they will walk with me in white, for they are worthy. Verse 5, he who overcomes shall be clothed in white garments, and I will not blot out his name from the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Now, in all seven of these churches, the letter of Christ to them references their labor or the works that they have been doing. I know what you have been doing. To five of the seven churches, on the basis of what they have been doing that Jesus recognizes are their laborers, he calls upon them to repent. Now, a church is not a building. A church is not a campus. It's not 5 acres like we are. It's not this building. It's the people. It's the people that make up the church. The church of Jesus Christ are the people, not the denomination, not the religious rule. It's you and I. And when Jesus is writing these letters to seven churches, he is not writing them to the buildings. Some have suggested that he was writing these to the angels of those churches. There is some basis for that, I would suggest, but indeed, if it was, then these angels were to refer them to the church itself. Once again, because the church is not a building, the church is not a city, the church is people. You are the church of Jesus Christ. And to five of the seven churches of Revelation chapter 2 and 3, he calls them to repent, which if you were to look at the church of Jesus Christ today and suggest that there are seven arenas or seven categories of churches today, five of those are in need of repentance. Because Jesus has an issue with what they are doing or, in some cases, what they're not doing. To the city of Sardis, to the church in Sardis, this is a church in what we would refer to as Turkey today or Asia Minor. You can go and visit that ancient city. You can see the ruins of that ancient church. It does not exist today. Oh, there is a Christian church in the city that now is or was the city of Sardis, but it has no relationship to the church that Jesus wrote this letter to through John at the close of the first century of the Church of Jesus Christ. And the warning of Jesus is this: you need to repent. You need to start persevering. You need to hold fast. You need to stick to the things which remain. Be watchful. Strengthen the things which remain. Hold fast and repent. Now, there was trouble in those days for the church of Sardis, as many of the churches in the first and second century, as Roman rule would make its way, of course, around the Empire of Rome in the Mediterranean arena. Many Christians were persecuted. They were martyred. They were put to death. They were gathered in great hordes and brought to Rome as toys for Caligula and other emperors to be used in the great stadiums, to be torn apart by animals and made examples. We're not sure exactly what happened with the Church of Sardis, but it ceased existing. The point that is intriguing in this, in verse 5, is if you overcome, in other words, if you do repent and hold fast to the things which remain, in verse 2, you will be clothed in white garments. There is a lot to be said about persevering in the faith. It sends a message to us that we need not wander from the cross very far. We must not. We must remain clinging to the Rock of Ages. We must remain clinging to the cross of Christ. We must remain anchored in the Holy of Holies by the very name of Jesus himself. The conditional issue in this point is if you do not persevere, if you do not hold fast, if you do not repent, what will occur? Jesus says that he will blot their name from the book of life. This is very troublesome for many Christians, particularly Calvinists, who believe that once saved, always saved. Now, I'm not going to take a whole lot of time trying to break down either the truth of that or the problem with that. I'll just say this. The message of Christ here is we need to hold fast and repent. In fact, the verbiage of repentance is one that needs to continue. Just as we are told in 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. It's an active tense verb when John says to the people that he's writing to, if you confess your sins, it is a conditional thing, but it's expected to be an active verb, something that lived out in you, that you are to confess. You are to agree with your sins with respect to Christ. But to confess means that there's been a position of repentance brought about by the Holy Spirit, convicting you of sin, convicting you of righteousness, and that you have dealt with that sin in the sense that in your soul you have said to the Lord, I with all that the Holy Spirit can gather in me, I will not do that sin again. Romans chapter 2, verse 4 tells us that it is the goodness, forbearance, and long-suffering of the Lord that leads us to repentance. It's not the crooked finger of your spouse or your neighbor convicting you or acting or attempting to act like the Holy Spirit to say to you where you have fallen short. We have all fallen short of the glory of God, have we not? And the end result of falling short of that glory is that the wages of sin is death. Death levies itself in us each time we sin. And Jesus has come that we might have life, and life abundantly in him. So repentance leads to confession, and if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. See, there then, repentance leads to holding fast. Holding fast leads to the white garment. The white garment leads to everlasting life in Christ. I know what you're thinking, because many Christians ask me, so does that mean I need to get saved every day? No, what it means is you need to confess every day, perhaps every minute. If you're like me, it's always on my mind. Because except for the blood of Christ, except for his propitiation, better learn what that word means. His expiation and propitiation. Except for that, I am lost in my sins. Religion dictates labor, works, gives me the reason to boast of my salvation. But au contraire, Christ and his blood, grace and faith, these are the things we cling to. So we come to church to worship him. We come in the midst of saints, knowing that eternity will be such things. To be gathering around the glassy sea with the midst of saints and worshiping him in spirit and in truth as Jesus prophesied. And knowing that, we must in this life continue to persevere. We must in this life continue to hold fast. I will not let go of the garment of Jesus, even his hem. I will not let go of the great grace that he has offered me. Because of what he did, not what I have done. Can you describe your life as one that is holding fast to Christ this morning? Holding fast to his righteousness this morning? Oh, I'll deal with that later on today. Quite a gamble to do such things. Now, if Jesus is writing this to the church of Sardis, who has a name. And believe me, there are a lot of Christians that believe because they're in a denomination that has a name. We've got a name and we're alive. And because I'm part of the denomination, I'm a card-carrying member of whatever, I'm saved. And Jesus says, no, you're not. You're actually dead. Because life comes through the blood of Jesus Christ. You're the church. You're always the church. And as the church, we are called to worship him in spirit and in truth. The spirit always leads to truth. And the truth of the whole matter with regard to us is this. We are sinners saved by grace, not by works, lest any man should boast. It is he who took us who were dead in our trespasses and made us alive in Christ Jesus. That's the gospel. And that's what Jesus is preaching to the church of Sardis. Once again, I repeat the fact that there were five of the seven churches that needed to repent. I wonder, I often think about this as the pastor. Jesus, what kind of letter would you write to this church? Once again, not writing it to the building, not writing it to one individual, but writing it to our church, to our congregants, to those that consider this to be our church. What would he say to us? Corporately, he might say, we need to repent. What do we need to repent of? Perhaps there are some in our midst, like he said to the church of Sardis, you're resting on your name, you're resting on your laurels, you're resting on your works. Could we suggest that that's a majority of our church? I pray that it isn't. Could we suggest that there are some in our church that are doing such things, that have not persevered, that are not holding fast? You hold Jesus loosely when it's convenient for you. You hold Jesus closely when you come to church, but the rest of the week, Jesus is just an acquaintance. You're not persevering. You're not holding fast. You're not strengthening the things that still remain in your weak approach to Christ. I pray to you this morning. I pray today is the day to run to Jesus and cling to the cross, for you may not have another day. And I'm not here to scare you with life's fragility, but we are all sinners saved by grace. Come and hold fast to Christ. Again, the book is referenced at the close, or near the close of the book of Revelation, when John writes, "Then I saw a great white throne and him," in Revelation 20, verse 11, "who sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and books were opened." What book was that? We're told in the next verse, or the rest of this. "And another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged according to their works by the things which were written in the books. And the sea gave up the dead who were in it, and the death and Hades delivered up the dead who were in them. And they were judged each one according to his works." You want works to save you? You will be judged by your works. If his work is what saves you, then you will be judged on the victory of his work. "And then death and Hades were cast into the lake of fire," which is the second death. "And anyone," note this, verse 15, "anyone not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. Was Sardis at the point where their name would be blotted out from the book of life?" Again, I guess we could speculate. But they're at the point, based on the warning of Christ, that that's exactly what could happen. Unless they repent, unless they hold fast, unless they strengthen that which remains. I ask you this morning, what remains in you? What is it that draws you to Christ this morning? What is it that you believe has improved upon the cross of Christ, has given you reason to have hope in the things that you've done? They are nothing but filthy rags before God. Christ and him alone. Christ and him alone. I'm intrigued by this book of life. It seems that Scripture describes this book of life having every name ever created in a mother's womb. Those that achieve birth and those that don't achieve birth. To the great solace of many women who have lost their children in midterm or at some point in their pregnancy. And along in life, and I don't know when, I've been asked, and I've asked the Lord as well, but there was a rabbinical tradition with respect to a term that is often passed around Christian churches, the age of accountability. At that age, somehow, and I don't know what age that is, God begins to account to human beings their works that are not under the blood of Christ. Now some in 1 Corinthians chapter 13 would suggest that love keeps no record of wrongdoing. But love demands judgment. I want you to know that. It is a loving God that must judge humanity based on the decision that you have propriety to make this morning with regard to Christ. Do you have Jesus? Are you a blood-bought, born-again, baptized believer in Jesus Christ? That's the only qualification for your name to be written back into the book of life. Oh, I was a sincere sinner. I don't know what age it was, but it was probably pretty young when my name was blotted out of the book of life because I was hell-bent for eternal death. I was even proud of it at one point in my life. But God, rich in his grace, confounding in his plan for my life, had something else in mind. And I will never tire of thanking him for that. Ever tire of thanking him for that. Having been saved by the blood of Jesus, not of works of my own, because I know that I would boast, God now keeps no record of my wrongdoing. He keeps record of my right doing. And one day, having been saved, having loved the great marriage supper of the Lamb, he will reward us for the great things that we have done because of his great name. So if you're concerned this morning with respect to holding fast to Christ, good, good. Verse 2. Daniel 12, verse 2. And many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, some to shame and everlasting contempt. We're speaking of the resurrections. And in fact, Daniel chapter 12, verse 2 introduces us not only to a resurrection that is soon coming, I believe, but to one that at the end of human history will resurrect all human beings to that judgment in Revelation chapter 20. There are, in fact, two great resurrections. The first resurrection started with the resurrection of Jesus and some Old Testament saints 3 days after his crucifixion. The second phase of that was when the resurrection of the church at the rapture occurs before the tribulation begins. Thirdly, resurrection of the two witnesses near the tribulation midpoint. And fourthly, the resurrection of the tribulation saints and the remainder of the Old Testament saints at the end of the tribulation period. The second resurrection is that which the writer of Hebrews told us about, is it appointed unto all men to die, and then the second death. That second death is an eternal death. It's not a seasonal death. There are no second chances in heaven. Garner Ted Armstrong used to profess in his Worldwide Church of God that God would provide all people a second chance once they had passed from this earth in heaven to decide whether, in fact, they may change their mind. I guarantee you, every person, every human being that has ever passed from earth is a believer in the Godhead of Jesus Christ. Some to the great glory of all eternity, some to the great vexation of their life, because they, in this life, in this world, chose not to honor him as the Lord God, Savior of all humanity. That is the unforgivable sin. I love the fact that God is going to raise our bodies one of these days. Paul, writing in the closing chapters of 1 Corinthians, says that in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, the dead in Christ shall rise. And the graves of Santa Maria Cemetery will open as those who have persevered, those who have held fast, those who have strengthened that which remained in this life will rise to meet their spirits and souls in heaven where they are as we speak this morning. Lucy's parents, Gordon and Eunice, and all the saints of God who have passed from this earth, whose bodies are laying in a grave or are scattered as dust, God will resurrect, and they will join their worshiping spirits in heaven to give glory to him for all humanity. It was suggested as I was listening to a podcast, and I like this suggestion. There's really nothing in Scripture, but it lends to a decent suggestion that in fact the spirits of those in heaven at this point right now long and anticipate that event when their bodies shall join their spirits in heaven. What a great day that will be. Great day. Verse 3 of Daniel chapter 12 says, those who are wise shall shine like the brightness of the firmament, and those who turn many to righteousness like the stars forever and ever. Oh, how I love that. I happen to love looking in the evening or the early morning into the universe to see the stars, to see the moon coursing across the sky from east to west. I just love that. In the summertime, you have to stay out pretty late before the stars really begin to show their power. But have you been in the mountains? Have you been camping? Have you looked into the desert sky late at night and just stood in awe of how many stars there are? Gabriel is telling Daniel here that those who are wise shall shine. The Hubble telescope has opened the heavens for us to be in awe of what stands in the universe that naked eye can't see, but pretty powerful telescopes show us, is the artwork of an intelligent designer who has painted the universe with the stars that worship him. We will shine even brighter than them. Their beauty will be exceeded by our beauty. Looking at this picture, did you know that that is a gaseous expanse way far away? And to go from its widest point to its widest point would take over a million years at the speed of light to cross. We're looking at something that is so large that scientists really don't have a means to explain its size. We make estimates with respect to the distance of things. Geometry has allowed us by measuring angles in our solar system to extrapolate distances in the universe, and it's a really rough, pretty mediocre remedial mathematics. But there is no doubt in our mind that the expanse of the universe is far beyond what humans are really able to calculate. And God says, the wise. Who are the wise? Are there any wise among you this morning? You shall shine with the brightness of the very foundations and firmament of the heavens. And those who in this life are used by God to turn people to righteousness. Is that you? Parent, have you turned your children to righteousness? Husbands and fathers, have you prayed over your children and spoken to them the power, the mystery, the mystic of God's word, and preached to them the righteousness of clinging, of persevering, of holding fast to that which remains? You, dear friend, will be like the stars forever and ever. Oh, my goodness. Who is like you, oh God? Who is compared to you? In Proverbs chapter 4, the writer there says, but the path of the just is like the shining sun that shines ever brighter into the perfect day. And weigheth the wickedness like the darkness, for they do not know what makes them stumble. I love the Word of God. I love the righteousness that comes by teaching me through His Holy Spirit how to persevere, how to hold fast to that which remains. Verse 4, as we come to a close in Daniel chapter 12. But you, Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book until the time of the end, when many shall run to and fro and knowledge shall increase. Now that term, seal the words, interestingly enough, is a term that was often given to writers of important historical scrolls. These seals would hold its testimony inside the scroll as true as long as the seal was not broken. And in contracts between people, covenants, testaments, they would be sealed by ribbons. In the case of that which becomes, as it were, the last of the great scrolls of heaven, and the first seal is broken in Revelation chapter 6, the earth responds as it quakes at the power of the hand of our Savior Himself, who is about to open the scroll, the deeds to heaven and earth, and lastly take control of all things that exist. Seal the book, he is told, Daniel is told, when until the time of the end? When will we know it is the time of the end? Well, Daniel is told the time of the end, long after Daniel's life, it will be a time when people shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall increase. Now, in Daniel's day, people ran to and fro at about the impossible speed of about 35 miles an hour. The very fastest steed or horse they could come up with could probably achieve about 35 miles an hour. The horses that run in the derbies run at full gallop about 35 miles an hour. If you're a fan of the Lone Ranger, he is constantly riding Silver at full speed no matter where he goes. I'm here to say to you, horses can't run like that forever. Sorry, Lone Ranger, Silver's tired. But 35 miles an hour, that was it. Well, 2,500 years later, speeds really didn't increase until the early decades of the 20th century, when modes of transportation began to change very quickly. That's 2,500 years after Daniel. Nobody prior to the year 1900 went much faster than about 35 miles an hour with the best of steeds, and it wasn't for very far. The new maglev, and that's a term that means magnetic levitation trains today. In Japan and in Europe have been clocked as fast as 268 miles per hour. Nothing touches the tracks. Now, that's not a train. But did you know that there are production automobiles today that can reach 267 miles per hour, such as the Bugatti Veyron? Well, they come at a big cost. They're about $1.5 million a piece, and you have to get your name on a waiting list years in advance because every one of them are handmade with about an 1,100 horsepower engine in them. There is an airship that has been a part of the spy system of America. It's called the Blackbird. The Lockheed Blackbird. Measured at 2,193 miles per hour in 1976. Of course, it's classified information. How fast these spy planes can go, but they have no missile defense system. Their missile defense system is when a missile is shot at it, it just speeds faster than the missile can go, and the missile runs out of gas. Some have suggested. Now, with this knowledge, you can't have a hot dog later. Some have suggested that they are capable of Mach 5. That's a phenomenal speed. Your basic 22 caliber bullet at sea level will pass the speed of sound at about 1,000 feet per second. These things, faster than a speeding bullet, these things, possibly 5 times the speed of a 22 bullet. What about the increase of knowledge? See, Daniel is told that not only things humans will be going to and fro, but knowledge will increase. Did you know that it took about 1,700 years from the crucifixion of Christ for knowledge in this world to double once? 1,700 years. Since 1700, scientists have noticed that human knowledge doubles about every 100 years until 1900. By the end of World War II, knowledge was doubling every 25 years. Today, things are not as simple as different types of knowledge, which had different rates of growth in those days. Nanotechnology knowledge is doubling every 2 years. Clinical knowledge is doubling every 18 months. On an average, human knowledge is doubling every 13 months. IBM, Bill Gates, recently said that their current build-out of the Internet of Things, I don't really know what that means, will lead to the doubling of knowledge every 12 hours. So, that computer you bought yesterday afternoon, it's out of date today. So you got to keep buying them, right? And what a great way of marketing. Isn't it astonishing? Jack Van Impe, not a huge fan, but I like him. He said, isn't it strange that expositions of this book, Daniel, were not attempted until recent times? No expositor made and published an attempt to explain Daniel verse by verse until the 20th century. Could it be that the fourth verse of Daniel chapter 12 is speaking of a time that Daniel is to seal this scroll up until people are traversing to and fro very quickly, and knowledge is increasing? Will we go faster? We probably will. Will knowledge increase? It probably will. But not, it's exponential. It's logarithmic at this point, friends. And Daniel's sweet testimony, it's a mystical, wonderful, God-breathed word that is becoming so relevant for us today. 4 visions of Daniel, we have to attest to the fact that he has nailed it every single time. The Lord has nailed it through Daniel. Let's close with this thought in mind. There is no time like the present, friends. There is no era that is more likely for the church, the bride of Christ, to be caught up unto heaven by our sweet bridegroom. Question is this in Matthew 25. Are you one of the 5 virgins whose lamp is filled, whose wick is trimmed, and is burning brightly as you hold fast, as you persevere That's the question. That's the issue that lies on my mind today.